Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 11th meeting of the Scottish Government Handling of Harassment Complaints Committee. Our first item of business is an evidence session on phase three of the inquiry, which is on the judicial review. Alistair Allen cannot be with us today, and Tom Arthur is attending as a committee substitute. May I ask Tom Arthur to declare any relevant interests?
Thank you, Convener. I have no relevant interests to declare.
Thank you very much. Can I remind all those present and watching that we are bound by the terms of our remit and the relevant court orders, including the need to avoid contempt of court by identifying certain individuals, including through jigsaw identification. The committee as a whole has also agreed that it is not our role to revisit events that were a focus of the trial that could be seen to constitute a rerun of the criminal trial. Our remit is clear, and it is to consider and report on the actions of the First Minister, Scottish Government officials and special advisers in dealing with complaints about Alex Salmond, former First Minister, considered under the Scottish Government's handling of harassment complaints involving current or former ministers and procedure and actions in relation to the Scottish Ministerial Code. The more we get into specifics of evidence, that could be time, people, cases, the more we run the risk of identifying those who made complaints. The more we ask about specific matters covered in the trial, including events explored in the trial, the more we run the risk of rerunning that trial. Wherever possible, can witnesses, as well as members, please avoid discussion of the specifics of concerns or complaints and also avoid naming specific government officials. Can members please ensure when asking a question on a particular government record that they give the document reference and also the footnote reference to the witness for their ease? We held an exploratory session with the Permanent Secretary and the Lord Advocate on the 8th of September in the absence of documentation about the judicial review that we had requested. We have now secured the release of more documentation, most notably the open record from the proceedings. Although the committee is still waiting on a lot more documentation, we agreed to begin taking oral evidence from Scottish Government officials who were involved in the judicial review process. And in particular, those who appeared before the Commission and diligence hearing in December 2018. This is the first of those evidence sessions. With that, can I welcome Judith McKinnon, the Director of People Advice. And can I ask Mr. McKinnon if there is anyone else with you that should be introduced?
No.
No, thank you very much. The committee has agreed that Ms. McKinnon's evidence will be broadcast in audio only. And I begin by inviting Ms. McKinnon to take the oath. Can I ask you please, Ms. McKinnon, to raise your right hand and repeat after me. I swear by Almighty God that I will tell the truth, the whole truth. Sorry. Thank you. That I will tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
That I will tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
Thank you very much. And can I invite Ms. McKinnon, please, to make an opening statement?
Convener, these opening words aim to give context about my role and responsibilities as Deputy Director for People Advice in the Scottish Government People Directorate. I've been the head of People Advice since August 2017, when I joined the Scottish Government. My division includes HR policy, reward, employee relations, and people advice and wellbeing. Of particular relevance to the committee will be my responsibilities around the development of HR policy and the translation of those policies into practice via the People Advice and Wellbeing team, who advise managers and staff in employee relations matters such as discipline, grievance, attendance management, and early intervention. I have responsibility for over 50 staff, with a high percentage of those being professionally qualified. I have a postgraduate diploma in personnel management and a master's degree in employment law. I'm a fellow of the CIPD and until last year was active in the CIPD Scotland network. I have worked in HR management positions since 1992, including 15 years at director level and in a range of private, public and voluntary sectors. I have considerable experience in carrying out and advising on workplace investigations and employment tribunals. And I am the head of profession for HR in the Scottish Government. Conduct that amounts to bullying and harassment is not and should never be tolerated in the workplace. As a result of the Me Too movement in 2017, the focus was increased substantially, which reinforced the importance of a range of work within the People Directorate to tackle bullying and harassment and promote an inclusive workplace. When I joined the Scottish Government, much of this work was underway and I had particular responsibilities to deliver our commitments. My role within the judicial review process was as a provider of information as the investigating officer, which included attending the Commission and diligence on the 21st of December 2017. I was not a decision maker in the judicial review process. In the interest of full disclosure, I should say I am a member of the FTA. And finally, as has been set out previously, I'm giving evidence to the committee on behalf of ministers and not in a personal capacity. This is complex legal territory, so I ask the committee's forbearance if I have to stop to seek advice or follow up in writing with detail to ensure accuracy and that all the government's legal duties are fulfilled. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Before I open up questions to the committee, I just have a question, please, Ms. McKinnon. I would like to know where you sit in the staff structure in terms of who your immediate line manager is, who your DG is, and the steps up to the permanent secretary, please.
Yes. So my immediate line manager is Nicola Richards, who's the director of people. And Nicola reports to the director general of organisation development and operations. And the DG reports to the permanent secretary.
Can you tell me who the DG was at the time of the judicial review?
At that time, it was Sarah Davidson.
Right. Thank you very much. I'll now open questions to the committee, and I'll go first to Margaret Mitchell.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Ms. McKinnon. In terms of roles and responsibilities, by way of background, on the 16th of January 2018, you were appointed the investigating officer for Ms. A, and on the 24th of January 2018, Ms. B raised her complaint directly with you. Prior to this, in November 2017, you were involved in emails concerning the development of the policy. You provided a checklist of questions for use when talking to those making complaints. You sought legal advice on how to handle the complaints and were aware of the then informal complaints of Miss A and Miss B. And in December 2017, you met with Miss A to discuss her complaint and the draft procedure and spoke to Miss B about her complaint and how it might be progressed. My question, therefore, is, did you have any doubts, even for one nanosecond, when you were appointed as investigating officer, given this previous involvement, that you might not be appropriate to take on that role?
No, I did not have any doubts about taking on the role of the investigating officer. When we discussed the requirements of an investigating officer, there were four main requirements. One was that it had to be a relatively senior member of staff who had experience in matters such as this. There had to be unconnected to any of the individuals and have no involvement in what was being complained about. It was very sensitive issues that were being raised, and it was very important to retain the confidentiality around those issues. And there was a real need for the IO to be able to dedicate the time to carry out the investigation. So our focus was on my lack of involvement with anything to do with what was being raised. And my role in the prior contact was absolutely in line with my role as head of people advice.
Some may find that strange, Ms. McKinnon, but can I ask, at what point in the judicial process, given all of your prior involvement with the complainers and the substance of their complaints, were you aware of and did you acknowledge there could be a perception of bias?
So I was always upfront about prior contact as it was happening and later on as the judicial review process developed. And I became aware that through the development of the pleadings I can forward between the lawyers, that there were questions being asked about the nature of the prior contact in November 2018. My understanding was that the original petition was not about prior contact. There was a range of other issues that were raised, which was the basis for the petition. But the issue of prior contact came up further questions were asked in November 2018. And I was asked to provide information about the nature of the contact. And I did that at that time.
When you're aware of it, when did you acknowledge that there could be a perception of bias?
At that point in time, I don't think there was an acknowledgement of a perception of bias. There was questions about what the prior contact was. My understanding, the decision about apparent bias came through the judicial review process. And that was the
another way. Do you now accept that there could have been a perception of bias, given all of this involvement with the complainers and the substance narrative of their complaint? Judicial review and prior to you being appointed investigating officer.
I understand the reason that was given for the concession, which was of apparent bias. I thought my involvement was appropriate throughout the prior contact and the appointment to the investigating officer. And I wouldn't even have thought at that point in time that apparent bias would be a problem.
You don't acknowledge it as a problem, is that the case?
I acknowledge that was the reason for the petition to be conceded. Absolutely acknowledge that. And I think that I think part of the challenge was the role of the investigating officer is set out in the procedure. So in earlier drafts of the procedure, we very clearly set out the role of the investigating officer, which included very clear description of the engagement that the investigating officer could have with potential complainers. And through drafting changes of the procedure, that detail was removed. And the final phrase that was left in paragraph 10 of the procedure, which was that the IO would have no involvement with the issues being raised, it seems left that open to interpretation and potentially of accusations of apparent bias.
Final question, convener. You sought legal advice. I think that was document XX037 and footnote 23. And at that point, an email was sent to by you just confirming that you were now aware, had been made aware, and that it would be helpful if some of the individuals could provide corroboration to the complaints you were already aware of. Does that not indicate that you had made up your mind substantially about these complaints even before you were appointed investigating officer?
No, I absolutely refute that I had made up my mind about anything. The complainers came forward and I investigated as appropriate.
Thank you. Go on now to Angela Constance, please.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to Ms. McKinnon. Ms. McKinnon, in your opening statement, you gave an outline of what the thrust of your job responsibilities were. What I'm keen to do is unravel some of the distinct strands of your involvement. And while we are absolutely here today to focus on the judicial review, I think it would be helpful if you could give a brief summary for the record here today of your involvement in the development of the policy, the new harassment policy that included current and former ministers, because it would appear that your involvement, that you were quite involved in that.
So the development of the procedure was led by James Hind, and he was supported from an HR perspective by Nicola Richards, by myself, and by members of my team also. And also he was supported by a senior employment lawyer as well. So James was leading on the procedure because of his knowledge and expertise of the ministerial code. I had wider responsibilities than in terms of the Fairness at Work procedure and the development of the new route map to allow people to come forward in various different ways. So I wasn't leading in any way on the development of the procedure. I was providing, I saw iterations over email mostly, and I provided comment as appropriate, and so did other individuals as well.
So you weren't performing a leading role, but you were most certainly involved in the development of that policy. That would be accurate, wouldn't it?
Yes.
Okay. And you, in questioning from Margaret Mitchell, you spoke about the other role in this affair, which is around your role as the lead investigating officer. Now, that was certainly an area in which you led on. Would that be correct?
Yes.
Okay. And how often did you report to your line managers, Nicola Richards and Sarah Davidson? Was that weekly, fortnightly, monthly? Was it informal supervision? Is there a written documentation? How did they oversee your work?
I throughout the investigation, I sought legal advice all the way through. I updated my line manager on a regular basis on the progress that was being made. So in terms of numbers of witnesses, for example, I'm seeing X number of witnesses next week, things like that. So it was really just on the progress of the process I updated my line manager on.
And did you have any direct involvement or contact in terms of your work as investigating officer with the Permanent Secretary?
No, not during the investigation, I didn't.
And the legal advice that you were seeking during the investigation, was that legal advice solely in terms of the investigation?
Yes.
Now, you've already said, Ms. McKinnon, that in terms of the judicial review, that you were not a decision maker. But again, your involvement was required. Can you just give us, a brief overview of what your involvement in the judicial review process was?
Yes. So I was required to provide information to help inform the responses for Scottish Government's pleadings. I attended regular update meetings with a range of colleagues to consider how it was progressing and comms and media aspects that might have to be considered. And I had a particular role to update the complainers on the progress of the judicial review process, which I did on a regular basis.
And you also mentioned earlier, Ms. McKinnon, in a reply to Margaret Mitchell, that you were always, and I'm paraphrasing you, were always upfront about your prior contact with the complainants. Can you therefore give an indication of what information you shared with whom, when, about your prior contact?
So So in terms of planning to meet with the individuals, I was taking advice, legal advice, to help inform those meetings. Nicola Richards knew, and I understand she was briefing her line manager. So it was all absolutely known by the people who were involved that the nature of the prior contact I was having.
Is there a written record of that anywhere other than what emerged during the judicial review process?
Well, I guess some of the documents that have been provided to the committee are my things like my one-to-one notes with Nicola Richards, where clearly talking about what was happening or what might have to happen and scenario planning. I also was having discussions with my contact in the legal department on a regular ongoing basis.
And my final question, convener, Ms McKinnon gave quite a detailed justification of her actions and involvement to the deputy convener. But can I just put it slightly different? Hindsight is always 20/20. So with hindsight, would you have done anything differently in relation to any of your roles in terms of the development of this policy, your leading role in the investigation, or your involvement in the judicial review?
So I have experience in HR procedures and investigations. What I did not have was experience of a judicial review process. I didn't understand the separate and legal distinct legal tests that take place in judicial review process, and I would have found it to be beneficial to have understood that in a lot more detail prior to the process beginning. In terms of the process, the process was unusual because it affected civil servants and also ministers and former ministers. And so maybe we could have retained the clarification in the policy that had set out initially that detailed role of the investigating officer, so that there was, to avoid any doubt about what the role of the investigating officer could be.
Forgive me, Ms McKinnon, but is that not the job of government lawyers and legal advice that you advised, that you and your colleagues were seeking throughout the process?
Well, as you said, the benefit of hindsight, we were clear about our interpretation at the time, we were clear about our intention of the role of the IO from those early drafting stages, and it was merely a tidy up of policy, which affected a change. It wasn't a change of intent and what was expected of the investigating officer.
Okay, I'll leave it there, convener.
Thank you. Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning, Ms McKinnon. You received a note from Ms Russell on the 22nd of November outlining the concerns raised by Ms A. Was this the first time you were aware of any concerns about the behaviour of Alex Hammond?
Yes.
So one of the concerns that would ultimately be investigated under the procedure was historic from 2013 and had been handled internally initially with an apology proffered by Mr. Salmond. Had you no knowledge of any kind of that prior to the investigation?
No, I did not.
Okay. I want to turn now to the procedure itself and your involvement in that. And you've already admitted that or confirmed that you had a role in drafting that. And as part of that drafting process, at some point in November, you gave a copy of the draft to one of the complainers, didn't you?
No, that's not true. A copy of the draft policy was provided to one of the complainers by Nicola Richards in December 14.
I understand. But did that happen with your knowledge or in your presence?
I was aware she was sending it to her.
Okay. And did you feel that that was appropriate at the time?
Well, it's common practice, actually, if someone is considering making a formal complaint, that they understand the process that we would then have to invoke so that they know what to expect of the process and what we expect of them. So it's actually quite common practice.
Is it common practice to share a procedure that's not actually been signed off and is still in draft form?
Well, I don't know if it was common practice, but it's not ideal that it wasn't finished off. It hadn't been signed off, but it was at the very late stages, and Mizzy was notified that it was still in draft. She was made aware of that.
Okay. So did you at any point in your discussions with Miss A or Miss B reveal that other people with concerns were considering coming forwards?
I think, again, that was Nicola Richards who had mentioned that in her email to Mizzy. And she did that. It's common practice in a person-centred approach. And we had taken advice from Police Scotland on that matter as well.
Did that come up in the private discussions you had with either of the complainers?
No.
Okay. So you were appointed as senior investigating officer, as we know, and I'd like to specifically bottom out the sort of semantic issue. And I think there is a semantic issue here in paragraph 10, and that defines that the person, as in the investigating officer, will have no prior involvement with any aspect of the matter being raised. That paragraph is there to prevent the appearance of bias, isn't it?
Yes.
So can you explain to the committee why paragraph 10 of the policy permitted you as a senior investigating officer in charge of the complaint? Why did it permit you to do that when you'd had prior contact with these complainers?
Well, as I explained to other members of the committee, the role of the IO had been set out in more detail in earlier iterations. And when it changed through those drafting iterations into what it became in paragraph 10, it was the intent for the role of the IO had not changed. So in terms of the intention about what an IO would do was still there. It was a drafting, it was a tidy up because it was a policy which generally wouldn't normally have that level of detail in it. And what we would normally do, and we were unable to do it at this point in time because of circumstances, policies generally have procedures and guidance attached to them with more information and detail, and across our standard HR policies within Scottish Government, that is exactly what we do. And we hadn't had time to create that guidance to go with the policy at the time. However, the role of the IO was very clear from early doors in terms of what was expected of the IO.
So in your answer to Angela Constance just now, in her question about hindsight, you suggested that actually you would have made paragraph 10 clearer as to what it meant by no prior involvement in the matters to which were being discussed. I take it then that the committee should infer that the intent of paragraph 10 does not preclude an investigating officer having prior contact, taking the complainers through the procedure, perhaps even revealing the existence of other complainers to those potential complainers.
The initial drafting was very clear about the prior contact that could take place, and that's how I operated.
Okay. Can I move off that? And one final question, if I may, convener. You were following, as we all were, the process of the judicial review, and it became clear ultimately that the penny drop moment was around the suggestion of apparent bias in your application of paragraph 10. Were you at any point aware of the repeated requests by Mr. Salmond to have the legality or the lawfulness of the application of the procedure determined by not rather than judicial review going through formal arbitration, which would have resolved this behind closed doors but with equal legal weight?
I wasn't aware of arbitration offers. I was aware of mediation offers, which is different, but I wasn't actually aware of arbitration offers.
Okay, that's fine. Thank you.
Thank you. Alison Johnson, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, Ms. McKinnon. Can I ask if you were shocked at the outcome of the judicial review and the finding that the Permanent Secretary's decision, report and letter were unlawful in respect that they were taken in circumstances which were procedurally unfair and in respect that they were tainted by apparent bias. Was that a shock to you?
I think because I had, yes, it was, is the straightforward answer. I felt that I had acted appropriately throughout, objectively, fairly, and in line with the policy and the process. And so the final decision, I'm not a lawyer, so I'm not best placed to understand the technical nature of the decisions that were made or the basis for those decisions. Yes, I can't say I wasn't shocked.
And Mr. Cole-Hamilton touched on the fact that the developing policy for handling complaints against former and current ministers was shared with a complainant. And there's a suggestion in that email, it's footnote 46, document YY008. It suggested that the complainant, you know, might test whether this would have helped them at the time. Now, you suggested to Mr. Cole-Hamilton that would be normal practice. Is that something that you would recommend, or do you think it would be far better to share that with a complainant when it was actually a procedure that was agreed and in place?
Well, that would have been the ideal scenario if it had been. But as I explained earlier, that circumstances didn't allow for that. And it is important for us as we're developing HR policy and process to make sure they are workable. And part of that transition and translation from development of HR policy into practice is to consult and engage. And so to get some feedback from Ms. E about whether this would have helped her at the time, it was a learning opportunity for us to ask that question.
Okay. The Scottish Government obviously decided to oppose this in court. And I wonder if you were asked to identify, so they must have felt that they had a robust case, you would imagine. I wonder if you were asked to identify information, communications and documents such as texts and emails relevant to the Scottish Government's case in order for a thorough assessment of that case to be made.
Do you mean at the beginning?
Yes.
No, I wasn't asked to do that, no.
And with regards to the offers of mediation and arbitration from the former First Minister, was there anyone on the Scottish Government side that thought that may be a productive way forward? Was there anyone urging that might be a productive way forward?
I don't know the answer to that question. I'm sorry.
Okay. No further questions, Convener. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Myrtle Fraser, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Ms. McKinnon. I'd just like to follow up some of the questions around the issue of the judicial review that both Angela Constance and Alison Johnson touched on a moment ago. We know that there were some 15 meetings that were held in the Scottish Government between the 23rd of August 2018 and the 7th of January 2019 to discuss the judicial review. Can I ask you, how many of these meetings did you attend?
So I regularly attended maybe twice or three times a week meetings about the judicial review process. I don't know if those were the only meetings that were being held to discuss it. So the meetings that I was at were very much about updates and communications and media and information to be able to provide to the complainers.
Okay, thank you. And of the meetings you attended, was the Permanent Secretary present at these?
No, she wasn't.
And was the First Minister present at these?
No, she wasn't.
Thank you. I think you said earlier in response to Margaret Mitchell, you were not involved in the decisions being taken in relation to the judicial review. Can you tell us who was taking the decisions?
I am assuming it would be lawyers, people from the legal directorate, but I don't know.
No, okay. Were you involved in any discussions with lawyers, either internal or external, around the judicial review?
I was asked to attend one meeting with our counsel on the 19th of October, and that was she was asking information, she was gathering information really, asking about, I think there was a couple of particular things. She was asking about the development of the procedure, and she was asking about the incident in 2013 and how it had been handled at that point, and what my understanding of that was from the complainers. And also she was interested in the balance of fairness that we took in relation to the former First Minister. So those were the three main, and council kind of set the agenda for that meeting. That was what she wanted to talk about.
Okay, thank you. So that was the 19th of October, the one meeting you held with lawyers. Did you ever have sight of the advice that the Scottish Government had in relation to the legal advice the Scottish Government had in relation to the judicial review?
No, I didn't.
Okay, thank you. We know the Scottish Government then took the decision to concede the judicial review. Do you have any understanding of the legal advice that the Scottish Government then received as to why they should concede?
No, I don't.
You don't? Okay, thank you. I have no more questions. Come here.
Thank you very much. Jackie Bailey.
Thank you very much, Convener, and can I welcome Judith McKinnon to the committee this morning. I wonder if I could pursue just a couple of points with you that my colleagues have already touched on, just for further clarity. And let me start with saying just something that the Lord Advocate said to us on the 8th of September, that the identification of further documents on the interaction between the investigating officer, i.e. you, and the complainers made the case indefensible. Were those all your documents that were subsequently disclosed to the Court of Session?
I don't know if they were all mine, but I certainly did provide documents.
Can you tell me when that was? Because I don't think it was in the first release of documents to the court.
So the late provision of documents was the week starting the 17th of December, 2018.
Okay. Can I ask? Sorry. Please carry on.
I was going to say, at that point, I had received a citation to attend the Commission in Diligence. And attached to that was a very detailed specification requesting information from a range of sources from which I hadn't previously searched.
Ask why that was, because obviously for a documentation request at the Court of Session is quite serious. Why didn't the Scottish Government get you to search and provide those documents at the start in their response to the petition?
I don't know the answer to that question.
Okay. My understanding is the Court of Session was told on the 5th of November about your prior involvement with complainants. But of course, you and the Permanent Secretary, as a matter of fact, knew of your involvement prior to your appointment in January 2018. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. So when did you or your superiors have a discussion with the government's legal team about that point?
I don't, in relation to the judicial review, do you mean?
No, in relation to your prior involvement before being appointed as the investigating officer in relation to the judicial review that was ongoing at the Court of Session. At what point was that discussed with the legal team? That's the basis on which the case was conceded. Was there any discussion about this at any point?
Well, as I said earlier on, the issue of prior contract was known. I was upfront about that. My line manager was upfront about that. It was known. And
so, sorry for interrupting. When you say it was known, who was it known by, and was it known by the government's legal team?
It was certainly known by the lawyer that I took advice from directly, who works in SGLD. So I'm assuming they knew.
Let me try and unpack this, and you are trying to be helpful. Who was the lawyer you took advice from in the Scottish Government Legal Directorate, and when did you take that advice?
I took advice throughout the whole process, and it was the same individual.
Can I ask who that was? Because this is quite a key point. It was the point on which the judicial review changed. So I think this is, if you could recollect, who was it you took advice from about this particular issue, and at what point?
So I just need to be very clear what you're asking me here. I took advice from SGLD from the beginning, at the time when they were involved in developing the procedure, providing advice, and awareness of the
Can I intervene here for both of you? I think I'm sensing a reluctance to actually name a name. Can we have the position, the job position of the person in SGLD that you took advice from?
He was an employment lawyer.
This quite difficult because it is through Judith McKinnon's own evidence to us that she advised us that she took advice from a lawyer from the Scottish Government Legal Directorate, on this particular point. So I was simply pursuing that. Can you tell us when that advice was provided, both in terms of the specific question of you having had prior involvement with the complainants before you were appointed the investigating officer? I understand you will have taken advice as you've gone along, but it is on this specific point that the judicial review turned. So I'm interested to know whether you took that specific advice from whoever. We'll find out eventually who it was.
Yeah.
So come back in on that. Because can I say that I'm sensing that people would like to know who this person was. If we can't have the exact job title of this person, if they're a senior civil servant, it's perfectly acceptable for them to be named. Can I ask you to respond to that, Ms. McKinnon, as well as to Ms. Bailey?
He's not a senior civil servant. So I'm referring to the employment lawyer that I deal with on a day and daily basis about a whole range of things. And he happened to be involved at that time in the development of the procedure, prior contact, etc. So I was consistently engaging with SGLD.
Back to Ms. Bailey, and sorry for that interruption.
Thank you. Do you know whether this employment lawyer you spoke to was part of the Scottish Government legal team that was dealing with the judicial review?
I don't know for sure.
You referred to a meeting on the 19th of October that you attended with counsel. Okay. Did counsel understand you were involved with the complainants prior to being the investigating officer?
At that meeting, I don't know, because that's not what we discussed.
So there was no reference made to it at that meeting?
No.
There were meetings, I understand, on the 23rd of October, 25th of October, 2nd of November. Were you involved in those?
With counsel?
I don't know who they were with.
I wasn't involved with any other counsel meetings or lawyers about the judicial review process.
So you didn't contribute to any discussions with the Scottish Government legal team or anybody involved with the judicial review process other than, as you describe it, updates and comms and media people?
Yes, I wasn't involved in any oversight or decision-making part of the judicial review process.
Okay. So at these update meetings, can you tell us who was there without naming names?
There's a range of people. Comms people were there, legal person maybe, someone from PermSex office, people directorate.
Sorry, there were lawyers there? You just said a legal person?
Yes.
Okay, so people from the Scottish Government legal team that would have been involved in the judicial review were at those meetings, which is contrary to what you said to us before. You weren't involved with lawyers, is what you said with us before.
Those meetings were not about legal decisions. It was about updates and progress and how the judicial review process was progressing.
Okay, there may be a separation for you, but it is the same lawyers that were actually working on the judicial review. Can I move us on to an area that Angela Constance explored with you and refer you to documents YY023, YY021 and YY073, all provided to us by the Permanent Secretary on the 11th of September. I'll give you a chance to find the documents.
Could you describe what they look like? That might help.
Ah, well, I can't help you because we have just lots of pieces of paper from the Scottish Government. This was provided by the Permanent Secretary to the Committee on the 11th of September. It basically shows you drafting a route map and flowchart on the 7th of November that includes former ministers. And that was in discussion, following a discussion with the Permanent Secretary. Do you recall the documents I'm referring to?
Yes, the route map document, yes.
Okay, that's perfect. Because what it shows is you looking at a route map, a flowchart on the 7th of November that includes for the first time former ministers. That was following a discussion you had with the Permanent Secretary. Wasn't that the day before James Hine produced the first iteration of the policy?
I think the issue of the former minister's inclusion in the policy was established from the very beginning. I think it had been identified from an HR perspective. We'd identified it as a gap in our existing procedures, the Fairness at Work procedure. And I understand that James Hind had also made that assessment.
So when was the very beginning, as you described it, and what communication was there with James Hind beforehand, before the first iteration of the policy?
I can't recall exactly what that would be. I'll have to check that and come back to you.
You said at the very beginning. When for you was the very beginning?
So when we started drafting the policy or reviewing the policies, it was after the Permanent Secretary had announced to the workforce that she'd asked us to do a review of our procedures. And I think that was at the end of October, beginning of November. And so that was our request, if you like, to review what we have in place and make sure it was suitable and if not, did it have to be reviewed? So that was the start of the whole process for me.
Okay, so at that point, the inclusion of former ministers was identified as a gap. That was in a discussion between yourself and the Permanent Secretary. And so there flowed from that the route map and the flowchart. Is that accurate?
No, I'm not sure where you're getting the following a conversation from the Permanent Secretary.
Because my understanding was that you produced a route map and a flowchart on the 7th of November that included former ministers, and that was following, well, it might have been a minute rather than a discussion, but there was a conversation of some description between yourselves and the Permanent Secretary. And this was the day before James Hind produced the first iteration of the policy.
Okay, well, I need to go and check my records on that, Ms. Bailey, if that's all right.
Absolutely is. I appreciate it's a long time ago and you are not alone in having a failing memory. Would you remember who told you to include former ministers, or is that something you can come back to us on?
No one told us to include former ministers. We identified from an HR perspective after a review of our existing procedures that that was a gap.
Okay, thank you. I'm grateful if you can recall anything else, if you would let the committee know. We were told that you and others, something that Alex Cole Hamilton pursued with you, that you were in frequent contact with both complainants during November and December 2017. Could you tell us what was involved in doing that?
Well, I think, first of all, it's an exaggeration to say it was frequent contact. So my prior contact with the complainers was that they came to HR after they had already approached other members of the senior civil service. And they approached HR when they wanted to consider options for what they might do next. So I had limited contact with each of them. With Ms. A, I met with her on the 5th of December with Nicola Richards. Nicola Richards followed up with an email to her and copied me in on the 14th of December. And then Nicola went on holiday. So Ms. A had responded with some queries to that email to Nicola Richards copying me in, and I responded because Nikki was on holiday. And for Ms. B, I was asked, I think Nikki asked me to contact Ms. B, which I did, and we spoke on the phone on the 7th of December. During that time, I didn't know what the substance of her experience had been. She was just exploring what options that she had open to her. So following that call on the 8th of December, I issued an email to her with various options in it for her to think about. I didn't hear anything back from her after the 8th of December. So on the 14th of December, I dropped her a quick text to say, just checking you got my email. And she responded to say that she did, and that she was thinking about things. And my response to that was, well, you know, take your time and, you know, come back to me after Christmas. And I did not hear again from Ms. B until the 23rd of January. So that was more than a month later.
Did you tell either of the complainants that you were going to be appointed the investigating officer before the appointment actually happened?
I didn't tell them that. And at that point in time when I spoke with them, I didn't know that that was going to be the case.
Your pause suggests to me that somebody else did, though. Would that be an accurate inference from the before you answered my question?
I think in evidence that I've given today, I said that Nikki Richards had in an email to Ms. A said that it was likely I would be the IO.
Thank you. Your defence in relation to questions about paragraph 10 seemed to be that the early iteration of the policy allowed you to be involved with complainants at the same time as you were involved in the development of the policy. Can I ask you, did you not read the policy document once it was signed off, given the importance of it? Did you just simply not read paragraph 10 and understand what your responsibility therefore was? I mean, I genuinely find that hard to believe.
I was very clear about my role and responsibility in relation to the procedure.
Sorry, that doesn't answer my question. So you know, you quite rightly said that you were looking at early iterations of the policy and that allowed you to be both involved at the beginning and also as the IO. Okay. What I find hard to believe as a senior HR professional, you know, as you've demonstrated to us, that you didn't read the finished policy document where paragraph 10 makes clear the absolute separation of roles. I cannot believe you did not refer to that, particularly in your role as investigating officer, at all, and that your defence is early iterations of the policy, which was in draft form, allowed you to do both. I mean, I think you're straining the credibility of the committee to ask us to believe, as an HR professional, that you didn't read paragraph 10 when the policy was completed.
I did read paragraph 10, but paragraph 10 doesn't make explicit the separation of roles. I think that's open to interpretation. And that's the challenge that we faced. Their original intention, which was still there, because what finally appeared in paragraph 10, that detail was not there, meant that it was open to an interpretation, an other interpretation than the one that we had taken.
Well, can I say to Ms. McKinnon, it's not just me, the Court of Session interpreted it differently to you. Thank you, Convener, that's all my questions.
Maureen Watt.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Ms. McKinnon. Can I just clarify a number of things that have been brought up earlier and maybe probe a bit further? You said that throughout that advice was taken from a senior employment lawyer within Scottish Government Legal Directorate. Was there also advice from external employment lawyers taken, and if so, whom?
Not by me, not in this matter, by myself.
Aware of anyone out with the Scottish Government who gave advice on this?
I'm not, no.
You said at one point police were also consulted. Was that on a specific matter, or what was that on?
No, the Police Scotland were consulted on the generic issues that we were facing. So in terms of the Permanent Secretary's announcement to all staff and, you know, essentially inviting people to come forward and speak to us, we took advice on how best to respond to those individuals who may have been involved in difficult situations. So the advice from Police Scotland was around, you know, how to support and take forward individuals who step forward and are raising things that are, you know, significantly of concern to them. They provided us with quite a lot of sources for support for staff as well. So in terms of, you know, outside organisations where people might be able to get help and support, voluntary sector organisations and such. So it was general information they were providing that would help inform our approach to what we might then have to deal with.
Okay, thank you for that. It's really important that we separate the difference between mediation and then the subsequent arbitration. So in terms of the former First Minister's preference for mediation in relation to dealing with complaints, was that discussed with the complainants? And if so, how many times? And was it the complainants that rejected mediation? And were they of one voice, or were there's different voices between the two?
So I think this matter specifically will be dealt with in the next with the next statement and tranche of documents that's still to come. What I can tell you, and what I know is that the mediation was against the wishes of both complainers. The opportunity was put to them, and they declined.
Okay, and in terms, was there a note on that put to ministers?
I don't know.
Okay, and in terms of the arbitration, was that rejected unanimously by the government? And did you have any advice fed into that yourself?
I wasn't involved in anything to do with the offers of arbitration, I'm afraid.
Why do you say afraid?
Well, you're asking me as if I was involved, but I wasn't involved, so I can't help you on that matter.
Okay, so you were involved throughout this process, yet... So if you weren't involved, who, to your mind, was involved in taking the decision about arbitration?
I don't know. I would assume it would be someone more senior, certainly than myself, but I really don't know.
Okay, thank you.
I have a very quick question, please, from Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Convener. Further to your answers to Jackie Bailey, it's clear that the collapse of the judicial review hinged on your interpretation of paragraph 10 versus theirs. That difference of interpretation cost the public purse over £500,000. But we have been told repeatedly in this inquiry that this procedure exists to this day. Can you clarify to the committee that that paragraph 10 has sufficient guidance behind it so that that difference of interpretation can't ever happen again?
Yeah, so not yet is the short answer. And we have the Dunlop review has been instigated to review the policy as it currently stands.
So the public purse is currently exposed to the same risk as it was back in 2018?
We haven't used the policy again since, and now it's under review.
Okay, thank you.
I have a quick question, please, from Margaret Mitchell.
Yes, very briefly, Ms McKinnon, you say Police Scotland was contacted. I think it was in a juridic view. When were they first contacted, and who within Police Scotland was contacted? You said following the PSC's email to all staff.
Yeah, so I think it was this, I can't remember the full name of the department, Specialist Crime Division or something like that, that a number of officers came to speak to me in December 17.
Who made that contact initially with Police Scotland?
I'm sorry?
Who made the contact initially with Police Scotland?
So I got in touch with them. I asked a colleague for a contact name and I got in touch with them and asked to speak with them.
And who was that contact?
In Police Scotland?
Yes.
I can't recall the name, but I will check and come back to you.
That would be very helpful. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I've got a couple of questions, Ms McKinnon. To pick up from some of what has been said through this session, please. Most of it has been covered. However, you did say something in response to a question from Alison Johnson that I noted. I think Ms Johnson had asked whether it wouldn't have been better to wait until a policy was finalised before sharing it with a potential complainant. And you said circumstances didn't allow for that. I wonder if you could explain what these circumstances were.
What I meant by that was that the policy was not concluded. The policy was still in its final drafting stages. And people were coming forward with particular concerns. And so if people make a complaint, we have to investigate it. We are obligated to do that. We've got a duty of care to do that. And the policy, as it was at that point in time, still in draft. But that it was better to be able to use something that was in that final drafting stage to be able to show them.
Okay, thank you. Move on to the judicial review. First of all, you mentioned, as had probably been sent in to us, scenario planning that had been carried out. Can I ask you just to give us a verbal outline of what the scenarios being planned were in relation to the judicial review?
Well, I wasn't referring to the judicial review when I said that. I was referring to the possible concerns becoming formal complaints and how we would deal with those.
Ah, I see, I picked you up wrong. Apologies for that. Okay, to get proper to the judicial review, can you give me an outline, to the best of your recollections, of the evidence that you gave to the Commission on Diligence?
Yes. I was asked about a range of documents I'd already submitted. And I was asked to conduct further searches because there was still some gaps. And I provided further documents, but I was still not able to source all of them. And so I gave a commitment to the Commission to go away and do further checks.
So that was it, yes. And were you able to...
Sorry.
Were you able to provide... We'll start again. You go first.
So I was able to submit documents on the 27th of January to SGLD. And I continued to search over that weekend. And that's when I came across some of the texts, which I think are in the bundle for the judicial review statement, which had been on because I was aware that I had been texting with the complainer, Ms B, but I had deleted it from my phone. And just on the off chance, I checked on my iPad and the texts were still there. They hadn't deleted and on there too. And so those texts set out information in there about my contact with the complainers, Ms B, in relation to almost right through the entire time that I had connection with her. So it was very logistical back and forth with her. And there was also a text between Nicola Richards and myself about the meeting on the 16th of January, which made it clear that I hadn't travelled to Edinburgh, so I certainly wasn't physically in the meeting. So by the time I contacted relevant director and said I found these further documents, and this was on the 31st of December. And I was told, look, just pause on sending anything else through right now. There's discussions going on about potential next steps for the judicial review process.
Could you run that last part that you just said past me again, please? You were in the middle of putting documents together and you were asked to pause in doing that because...
Was to send them to SGLD because there was discussions happening about the next steps.
Right, and when was that? Refresh my memory.
That was the 31st of December.
Okay, thank you very much. I don't think there are any further questions unless someone's got something pressing at the last minute. No. Can I thank Judith McKinnon for her evidence today and... we'll now have a break of 2 minutes before moving to the next witness. Thank you, Ms. McKinnon. Can I welcome Barbara Allison? Thank you for coming along again, Miss Allison. And may I ask you to take the oath? Please raise your right hand and repeat after me. I swear by Almighty God that I will tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
I swear by Almighty God I will tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
Thank you. And I now invite Miss Allison to make a brief opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you for the opportunity of providing an opening statement for this session, in addition to the statement I gave to the committee on the 15th of September. For ease of reference and by way of a brief reminder about my current and previous role and responsibilities as Director of Communications, Ministerial Support and Facilities, and my previous role as Director of People with regard to matters which relate to the committee's remit. I've worked with the Scottish Government since 2008, following 14 years with the Scottish Prison Service, latterly as Director of HR there for 5.5 years. I was asked to join SG as Head of HR in January 2008 and subsequently promoted to Director of HR and Corporate Services in 2009. Since 2016, I've been Director of Communications, Ministerial Support and Facilities. This session is focused on the judicial review and related commission process. As I mentioned in my previous opening statement, in November 2017, I had some early and limited contact with two individuals who ultimately became complainants under the policy on handling of harassment complaints. Given the confidential restrictions which apply, I would ask the committee's forbearance if I'm hesitant about whether I can answer certain questions or if I seek advice from the convener or from SGLD legal team before doing so. In relation to my early contact with two individuals, I was asked to provide documents as part of the judicial review and attended the Commission for Evidence in December 2018. However, I was not involved in the judicial review in a decision-making capacity. To the extent that it may be relevant for today's session, although I had some early and limited contact with the complainers, I was not involved in the investigation process. Finally, I repeat that I'm giving evidence to the committee on behalf of ministers and not in a personal capacity. Convener, as the committee appreciates, this is complex legal territory, and as I've explained, I am privy to certain information that was subject of legal proceedings and the confidentiality of which is now protected. I ask the committee's patience if I'm cautious in answering questions on certain matters or if I will have to stop and seek advice or follow-up questions in writing with detail to ensure accuracy and ensure the government's legal duties are fulfilled. I again would wish to declare I'm a member of the FDA Union. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. Committee members have many questions to ask, and I'll move first to our Deputy Convener, Margaret Mitchell.
Yeah, good morning, Ms Allison. If I could ask some questions along the theme of commission and decision to concede. Were you involved in the Scottish Government's response to the commission as well as being cited as a haver?
I was asked to provide information on occasions to the commission.
Right. Can you outline what occasions these were?
So I was asked to provide a copy of the text that I had with Miss B, and there was a specification for documents on the 17th of December, and I provided a response to that. And other than that, it would be ad hoc information provided.
Right. And was that the limit of your involvement in terms of the Scottish Government's response?
Yes. I was involved in regular update meetings, but not there was update meetings and there was a decision where the decisions were being taken. I was involved in update meetings in connection with the judicial review.
Okay. Without going into detail on the specifics contained within the documents, what documents specifically were you cited as a haver to give evidence on? You've missed a text and document 17. Was there anything else you were cited specifically to give evidence on?
So there was a list of requirements on a specification on the 17th of December. I said I had already provided the texts to that I had with Miss B, and I confirmed that I had no other texts with her. I had no texts or WhatsApp contact with Miss A. In terms of the additional searches that I did on in relation to the 17th of December specification, I provided two additional documents to hand over to the Commission.
And these documents were?
One was a response to Miss Russell. Miss Russell and I had met Miss A on the 22nd, I think, of November, and there was a statement taken of her concern at the time. What I provided to the Commission at that time was me
providing Ms. Russell with some tracked changes to the note of that meeting. And the second document was an email to Ms. B, where I provided her the text of the Permanent Secretary's all-staff message on the 13th of November.
Okay, thank you. And are you able to say the nature of Ms. Russell's concern, as long as it isn't, you know, to do with the substance of the complaint from the complainers? I think you said Ms. Russell's stated concern in one of the first documents.
Sorry, so I, Ms. Russell and I met Ms. A on the 22nd of November, and there was a draft note produced of that, and I was responding to Ms. Russell with some track changes to the note of the meeting.
Okay, that's fine. You gave evidence to the commission hearing. Was that on the first day of the commission hearing, any other day?
It was on the 19th of December, yes.
Right. In what capacity did you give evidence? Was it as Director of Communications? Was it in your pastoral role? Was it in any previous role or any other capacity?
It wasn't clear in terms of what my capacity was.
And the evidence you gave then, what did it relate to? Which role?
So the evidence I gave to was in relation to my early contact with Miss A and Miss B.
And when you mean early contact, how long are we talking about?
So that was in November, November 2017.
Okay, thank you. I wonder, just to move on a little bit, in terms of the ministerial oversight of the judicial review process, which government ministers were regularly advised on the outcomes of the legal discussions?
I wasn't involved with that, but I'm aware that the Lord Advocate was involved, but I'm not aware of any other ministers being involved.
And did you update any ministers directly in your capacity as Director of Communication?
No.
Okay, thank you.
Convener, and welcome back to Ms. Allison. Can I thank you for your further letter to the committee identifying that you were indeed the recipient of the text message from the Permanent Secretary? And let me refresh both your memory and everybody else's about what was actually said. And this is from Leslie Evans. Thanks, Barbara. Battle may be lost, but not the war. Hope you're having lovely and well-deserved break. L. Your response, thanks, Leslie. It is lovely here. My mind and thoughts are with you all there, though. Best wishes be. Could I ask, what was the message that you sent that Leslie Evans was replying to?
I don't know. I don't have that. As I said, I didn't recall having received this message. I was answering to the best of my recollection at the time. After I left the committee, because I realised that you had some concerns with my reply, I searched my phone, I didn't have the messages, and I contacted the Crown Office in relation to anything that had been handed over in terms of the criminal proceedings, and that these were the two messages that they came back in relation to the question you asked.
And here was me thinking I had a poker face, Miss Allison, clearly.
Sorry.
Not. Can I ask, though, that surely what the reply was to would have been handed over to the Crown Office? Are you saying that message simply doesn't exist?
It wasn't handed back to me, so I'm assuming it doesn't exist.
Okay. Can you tell me when the messages were sent?
The 8th of January 2019.
So that would be significant, because that was after the collapse of the judicial review?
It was after the judicial review was conceded, yes.
Okay. Can I ask your understanding of what you interpret to be the battle and what you interpret to be the war?
I mean... Obviously, I didn't write the text, but I think in Permanent Secretary's earlier evidence, she talked about her continual focus on equality.
But in fairness, you don't disturb somebody on holiday in the Maldives to send a message about broader equality issues. Mm. It was directly linked to the collapse of the judicial review for the Scottish Government, wasn't it?
It was at that time, yes.
Yes. So given that she interrupted you on a well-deserved break, or you interrupted her, what was the battle?
I assume that it was connected with the judicial review, but as I said...
Okay, that's fine. That's what I would assume too. What, therefore, would you assume was the war?
I said I didn't write the text, so I don't know what...
I know. I'm asking you to interpret a text sent to you by somebody who clearly was close to you.
So my view is, Permanent Secretary has, since she came in 2015, made a concerted effort to ensure that people feel included and heard. I'm assuming it was the broad context of trying to make sure that women can come forward.
Okay. Let me move on to responses that you gave to me last time you were here. And let me ask again, did you write to or contact former staff to encourage them to complain to the police about the former First Minister?
No.
Really?
No, I did not. I did not write to... I'm very conscious of identification.
I'm not asking you to name anybody. I'm simply asking you whether you wrote to a former staff member or contacted them to encourage them to complain to the police about the former First Minister.
No.
You're quite certain about that?
Yes.
You didn't do it at the instigation of a special advisor?
No.
You didn't do it after the police started their investigation?
No, I remember there was contact when the police, it was initially announced as a police investigation, and there was some concern that names might have been given over who were potential witnesses, and whether they would be concerned about, about the police investigation. And there was some correspondence about, did we have to make contact, etc. And there was one particular person mentioned in relation to should they be, they weren't a former member of staff.
Okay.
So I'm aware of one particular person who was mentioned who was, and whether we should be making sure that they were aware and were okay.
And did you make that person aware?
I did not, but because I knew, I was told that they were already aware.
Okay.
So I'm sorry, Miss Bailey. I again realise that you seem to have evidence that
I'm smiling.
Yeah.
Right? I'm not expressing disbelief. I'm simply testing the point.
So if you have something, that you feel that I'm not providing, perhaps if you could give me some information about it, I'd be happy to respond to you on that.
Excellent, thank you. Have you ever expressed concern or had concerns expressed to you about interference by special advisers in the civil servants complaints process?
Could you ask that again? Sorry.
Okay. Have you ever expressed concern or have you had concern expressed to you about interference by special advisers in the civil service complaints process?
There was during the investigation, there was some correspondence between myself and some other people about somebody who was perhaps going to give evidence or witness. And in my pastoral care role, I was asked whether I could offer some support at that time. I think that's what you're probably referring to.
Okay. I will leave it there for now. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Angela Constance, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to Miss Allison. Miss Allison, in terms of evidence we've heard from you previously, you have said that you had no direct involvement in the development of the new policy on harassment, but you did have a role in pastoral care. We've heard that you had some contact with complainants, but you were not involved in the actual investigation. And you've said today that you were obviously a participant in the judicial review process, but you were not a decision maker. Can you therefore explain as much as you can why the Commission were interested in you, and can you explain about what evidence in terms of the substance that you had and why this was considered to be important?
As I understand it, as the judicial review went on, there was particular interest in early contact with Miss A and Miss B, and I think Miss McKinnon referred to earlier. So, as I've mentioned, so I had early contact with both. And I'm conscious that that the committee have not yet had the final tranche of evidence, which I'm sure would be helpful. Perhaps I could. So I had early contact with Miss B, and the contact that she and I had were a series of texts. I had, I think, three telephone calls with her, but no meetings. But there was never a record taken of any of her concerns. You know, that was the contact with Miss B. With Miss A, my one contact with her was, as I said, in relation to the meeting that Miss Russell and I had with her, where a note was taken of her concerns.
Okay, and why do you think that this contact and this information was important?
I think because it was the sort of early contact and just sort of understanding how that came about. And I understand both of them came about as a result of the Permanent Secretary's staff message on the 2nd of November, when she put a note out to all staff talking about cultures and behaviours and ensuring people felt that they were supported to come forward, etc. And it was, as my understanding, it was the result of that both individuals came forward.
Okay. And just to be clear, Miss Allison, in terms of the information that you held in terms of texts and a note of a meeting with one of the complainants, was that information made freely available in early course of the judicial review process? Or did you have to be asked for it?
So I made it known to Scottish Government officials that I had texts from Miss B, and I was then asked to provide them on the 12th of December, and the report, the note from Miss A, Miss A was already known about prior to that.
Okay. So when did you tell colleagues about the texts? When did you tell the Scottish Government that you had texts from one of the...
I can't recall. Sorry.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. And what involvement did you have in terms of seeking legal advice and legal support? Was that internal to SGLD? Was it external? You know, what was the nature and the flavour of that?
In relation to what, sorry, which...
Your involvement with the judicial review process.
I didn't seek any legal advice, to be honest.
Okay.
We were just asked to, you know, do the searches and then provide...
Okay. So your involvement in the commission and that hearing... you weren't supported with internal legal advice or support.
So
do you just pitch up like you did here today yourself?
So before the appearance at the commission on the 19th of December, there was a session with colleagues who were attending the commission and SGLD colleagues the evening before, when we were provided with an explanation about what a commission was and provided with the documents that had been already handed over. So it was quite ad hoc and quite late.
Okay. Is there a written record of that meeting at all?
I haven't seen it. I haven't seen it. I don't think so. I think it was more just a sort of informal meeting, but I don't think
okay.
It was a meeting.
And can you remind me, Miss Allison, who do you report to?
So I currently report to the DG, Organisational Development and Operations.
Mm-hmm. And at the time, who did you report to?
Same DG.
And that's in terms of the position, but are you able to name the person? I think they're senior enough.
At the time, it was Sarah Davidson. And
that's fine. And just one final question from me, Convener. Ms Allison, you have substantial public sector experience, and I just wondered, with all of your experience, with hindsight, is there anything that you or your colleagues could have done different?
I think certainly not being a lawyer and never having been involved in judicial review before, I think it would have been helpful to have been clearer exactly what was required of us and what would be expected of us in terms of providing information, etc. So I think in hindsight that would have been very helpful if we could have, if you know, the people who were involved ultimately had more information at the start.
Okay, so that's, you point to a lack of support from legal colleagues, perhaps, or a lack of awareness around judicial review processes. I suppose what my question was more pointed towards, is there anything you or your colleagues in your roles could have done differently?
I'm not aware of anything. I mean, I think we did everything that we were asked at the time that we thought, you know, we were doing correctly. I think, as I said, in hindsight, you know, I think we would have done it differently.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Convener, good morning again, Ms Allison. Thanks for coming back to see us. I'd just like to start by following up on a couple of questions from Jackie Bailey. Can I start by asking, Ms Allison, what kind of phone do you have?
Got an iPhone.
An iPhone, okay. And is it the same, regardless of whether it's the same handset, you've not changed contracts to the point where you would have to restore or completely restart a new phone or anything like that? Okay. So, and I'm not going to ask you to do this, but hypothetically, if we needed you to, could you access the text messages right now from the complainers that appeared in the judicial review?
Yes.
Okay, so you could access messages on your phone that were sent in 2017, but you're telling Ms. Bailey that when you searched your phone for the message that was replied to by the Permanent Secretary about losing the battle but winning the war, you couldn't find that.
Yeah.
Did you delete that message?
Yes, I mean, I have deliberately kept the text messages from Ms. B because I was very conscious that they were the only record that I had of my contact with her. And as I said, it was texts, some calls. And when I first took the call from Miss B, I was walking to work, and I didn't make a note of the call or anything that was said. And in fact, one of the texts back to her later on says, "I'm conscious that I've never taken a note, you know, of this, etc." So I was very conscious that it was a very strange time, as you might imagine, when people were coming forward with concerns. And somebody had come forward with something that they didn't feel they were able to share with the organisation at the time. And I felt I was trying to hold a space open for her, mm-hmm. Basically, and not be seen to be in any way, you know, closing down, dismissing or anything, but likewise not be trying to seem to force come forward. So I was very conscious that I hadn't made a note of it, mm-hmm. and the only thing that I had about the contact with her were the texts. So I kept those texts. I don't routinely keep all my texts. I will, you know, clear out texts, you know. So yes, I must have deleted some texts, but I know I specifically kept the text with Miss B for a reason.
But there was definitely forgive me if I'm not getting this right. There was a year, or rather, you sent a text to Leslie Evans to which you replied about winning the battle but losing the war. You'd kept texts for the year previous from complainers, mm-hmm. but you were deleted at some point in the near future after you received that text from Leslie Evans, your original text that sent to her. Do you have any recollection of what you sent to Leslie which precipitated that response?
No, I don't. Sorry. I didn't remember getting Leslie's replies. I don't remember what I initially said.
Okay, I'll move on. This is a slightly off topic, but I think it's important considering that you're here in front of us again. We received a letter from Sir Peter Housden last week to clarify that he had never discussed concerns about bullying behaviour on the part of Alex Salmond. And yet the dignity at work policy, we know, was changed in 2010 after trade unions raised concerns about bullying behaviour, specifically from Mr. Salmond, while you were the Director of People. One of the 2010 changes was that escalated complaints against ministers would be dealt with by the Permanent Secretary and the Deputy First Minister. So that's the person in charge of the civil service, but interestingly, not the person who's in charge of the government. It's their number two. Otherwise, it would be the First Minister. So it's hard to believe that Nicola Sturgeon would take on that role without understanding the subtext as to why. Was Nicola Sturgeon ever clear as to why these changes were being made and why she was being given that central role in dealing with complaints?
I'm not aware of that. I know that the Permanent Secretary spoke to the First Minister at the time about the change in policy, but I'm not. I don't know whether he spoke to the Deputy First Minister at the same time.
I accept that. But could we infer that reality of the response of changing the policy following the intervention by the unions raising concerns about concerns around the former First Minister's behaviour? This is another example of a procedure being redesigned so that it might one day potentially fit complaints against Mr. Salmond.
I think the unions certainly at the time had raised concerns about behaviours with ministers, and I recall that the First Minister was mentioned at the time.
Is it a reasonable interpretation for us to say that this policy was retrofit in order to be deployed should it ever be needed if a formal complaint came against the First Minister?
I can't recall why that particular clause was put into place.
Okay, so moving on to the handling of complaints. Without going into any detail that might identify her, can you describe the conversation in which Ms. A revealed her allegations against Mr. Salmond? For example, how did that come about? Who made the initial approach? What precipitated her to come forward?
So, as I mentioned, the Permanent Secretary's note of the 2nd of November to all staff. So that initially, I understand, precipitated a contact with Miss A, and then she had come forward to Gillian Russell to say that she wanted to share a concern. Separately, somebody had approached me to say that Miss A would like to have a chat with me in my pastoral role care, and we agreed we would see her together.
So did you get the impression that Miss A, perhaps in the understanding that of the environment everyone was in at the time with the Me Too and the knowledge perhaps that the harassment complaint was being updated, that she was actually sharing that with a number of individuals within her circle in the civil service?
I don't know.
Okay. So we knew that Judith McKinnon, or we know that Judith McKinnon knew of the complaints very shortly after that, on the same day, in fact. And 2 weeks previous, the Permanent Secretary had stated quite publicly that Judith would play a leading role in the management of harassment complaints. When those complaints surfaced, was paragraph 10 and the need to avoid apparent bias ever discussed at that point? Mm. Okay. I'll move on to the judicial review, if I may. Were you aware of the repeated requests by the former First Minister to ascertain the legality of the handling process through arbitration rather than judicial review at any point?
I was aware that arbitration had been mentioned.
And can you just expand on that? When you say you were aware, who made you aware of that?
In terms of the sort of regular update meetings, we were being made aware of just how things were progressing. So I was aware that I think mediation and arbitration had been mentioned. But that was, it was just an update meeting.
Sorry to press you on this, but can you expand on how it was mentioned? Was it a topic for discussion, or was it a matter of fact that arbitration has been suggested, but it's also been rejected?
It was more along those lines. The meetings we were in weren't making decisions or commenting. It was just an update meeting so that we knew what the current position was.
Because of your pastoral role with the complainers, were the complainers ever made aware that arbitration was had been suggested?
I wasn't at that point. That had gone beyond the stage where I had any contact with individuals.
I understand. Okay. Just a couple more questions, if I may. In terms of the judicial review itself, it's clear that there was a kind of drip feeding of documents, or on five or six separate dates, additional documents were requested. Why, if you could see the line of inquiry that the judicial review was taking, why was the government not more forthcoming in just producing everything of relevance at the one time?
I don't know. I mean, we were responding to when we were asked for things. I don't know why there's a particular approach been taken.
Okay. And then when the judicial review concluded and collapsed and the case was conceded, was there any kind of wash-up meetings that followed that within the higher echelons of the government to look at lessons learned and follow-ups?
I'm not aware. I wasn't in the country when we were conceded the... so I'm not sure whether there was anything immediately following.
And my final question, Convener, if I may. This was a £500,000 mistake that was made, and we've just learned from Judith McKinnon that 2 years after that case collapsed, this policy is still live and still open to the misinterpretation that led to the judicial review's collapse. Has there been, in your experience, any attempt in the last 2 years, other than the Dunlop review, to take remedial action on particularly paragraph 10 of the procedure?
I'm not aware of anything.
Okay, thank you. No further questions.
Alison Johnson.
Thank you, Convener, and good afternoon. Are you aware of the makeup of any group overseeing the judicial review and informing key decisions that the Scottish Government took? For example, which ministers were involved, special advisers, legal advisers and government officials?
So I wasn't involved in the the handling of that at all. I'm aware that there were meetings, and I'm aware that on occasions the Permanent Secretary, I think the FM attended some special advisers, etc., but I wasn't involved.
In your role as Director for Communications and Ministerial Support, I assume you would want to be assured that the government were confident that their case was robust. Did you have any discussions in that regard?
No, that was obviously the Permanent Secretary would have a view on that.
Okay. And do you have any knowledge of the legal assessment that was made between the 27th of December and the 2nd of January 2019 relating to that decision to concede?
No.
Okay. So you don't know what the key change was as at the 2nd of January 2019?
No, subsequently I have seen correspondence that I was copied into at the time, and I understand it was in connection with the para 10 and the investigating officer prior contact.
Okay. Can I ask, I asked Ms McKinnon this question, were you shocked at the outcome of the judicial review and it's fairly stark, the finding that the Permanent Secretary's decision report and her letter were unlawful in respect to that they were taken in circumstances which were procedurally unfair and in respect that they were tainted by apparent basis? At the time that became known, were you shocked at that outcome, having been involved previously in some regard?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. I have no further questions, Convener. Thank you.
Dr. Fraser.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning.
Morning.
Ms. Allison, a lot of the ground I was going to cover has already been gone over, so I've just a very few short questions just to follow up some of the questions around the judicial review. Alice Cole-Hamilton asked you about the issue of arbitration. Mm-hmm. It would seem to me that trying to resolve this by arbitration would have been preferable on a number of grounds. It would have been, in most cases, cheaper, quicker, and would have kept the matter private, which from the point of view of the complainants might have been seen as being an advantage. Do you have any understanding of why the Scottish Government refused to go down the route of arbitration?
No.
No. Okay, thank you. Were you involved at any point with discussions with legal counsel, either in-house or external, about the Scottish Government's legal position?
No.
No. OK. Okay, thank you. And did you ever see the Scottish Government's legal advice at any point?
No.
No, you did not. Okay. And one final area I want to cover is the role of special advisers. Were you involved at any point with special advisers in relation to the judicial review process?
So there were, as I mentioned, we had regular update meetings, and special advisers had been involved in those meetings.
Right. Okay. And what was their role in those meetings?
So the particular role was in terms of media lines and comms lines. So we might be getting press interest. So you know, they would be obviously interested in how we were responding to that.
And that was the extent of their role.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
No more questions. Thank you.
Maureen Watt.
Good morning. I'm Salson. You said you had more contact with Miss B than Miss A. In terms of the mediation that was offered, was it you that conveyed that to either Miss A or Miss B?
No, my understanding, the mediation offer was made when the investigation started. So that was beyond my point of contact. I had a point of contact up until HR took over, and I had no contact with either of them thereafter, other than two texts with Miss B in January 2018.
And was that in relation to the ongoing possibility of mediation or the judicial review?
The subsequent context was me texting Miss B to say thank you for my Christmas card, and her texting back saying you're welcome. So it was in connection, but just for the sake of completeness, I had to contact her then.
So it wasn't you that relayed the possibility of mediation?
No.
And then in relation to arbitration, no. Were they, you hadn't, that was HR that was...
As I understand it, yes.
Were you, in your senior role in government, copied in, were you one of the copied into people in relation to the judicial review decisions, and did you have any input into the judicial review decisions that were made by the Scottish Government?
No.
Okay, that's all. Thank you.
Okay.
Jackie Bailey?
Just a small thing, because you referred to regular update meetings in response to Murdo Fraser. Would these be the same meetings that Judith McKinnon described to us? So there'd be media people there, comms people there. I'm curious because she was asked a question about special advisers, and she said there were no special advisers at those meetings, but you've just said that there were.
Yes, there were.
Okay, so who should I believe?
Well, I think, the interests were particularly around comms, so perhaps Miss McKinnon hadn't recognised that was their interest.
Okay, so who were the special advisers that were there on a fairly regular basis or at all?
I don't know whether I'm at liberty to give names, sorry.
I'm happy
to come back on that.
They are senior people.
Is that okay? So the people who, Liz Lloyd were there on occasion, and this is dreadful, I've forgotten his name, Stuart Nicholson.
Okay. I'm sure he won't be offended at that. I'm sure he won't. I'm sure he'd want to be incognito. So Liz Lloyd and Stuart Nicholson were the two special advisers.
Who would on occasion be there, yes.
Okay. How often? I mean, we see that meetings were twice, if not three times a week from Judith McKinnon's evidence. Would it be once a month, once a week?
No, they would be there, for a comms interest, regularly there, one or other.
Okay, sorry to press you on this. Regularly is a very loose term. So would that be weekly? Would that be at every meeting?
I would say most meetings.
Most meetings. Yeah. Okay, so I'll take that, the majority of meetings. We can agree on that.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much. I think that's all.
Okay. And finally, to Margaret Mitchell.
Ms. Allison, you mentioned about the police investigation, about contact with the police as Director of Communication. Can you say what contact you had, either directly with the police, on anything really to do with the handling of complaints or any complaints against the former First Minister?
So I had no contact with the police at that stage. Right. My contact with the police was in terms of the criminal investigation. And because I had texts from Miss B, I offered my phone to them to get the text from Miss B from my phone.
Right. And are you aware of when Police Scotland were first contacted about the... I think Miss McKinnon mentioned after the Permanent Secretary sent an email out, a kind of generic email, then contact was made with Police Scotland. Were you aware of that?
I was aware that contact had been made with Police Scotland in connection with support to potential complainants, etc. I was aware, but that was...
Were you kept advised as Director of Communications?
No.
So how were you aware of that then?
Trying to recall how I became aware. I can't recall. I think it must have been just an update that they had been in touch on the basis just to seek advice on how they might take forward complaints like this. I can't really recall how I became aware, sorry.
Yeah. It's quite a big thing, really, to contact. It's not something that would happen every day. And as Director of Communications, would you have expected to be fully informed about that?
No. I think, I mean, in terms of, my understanding was HR got in touch because it was about how they might handle those type of complaints.
And would that decision be taken by Nicola Richardson? We know that Ms McKinnon contacted the police, but would that be her decision alone?
I don't know.
And just finally on the mediation stuff, I recall from your last evidence session you said you were quite a fan of mediation.
Yes.
So while you didn't make any decisions about arbitration or mediation, did you have a view on whether that would have been appropriate at all in the management of these complaints?
I wasn't asked for a view. I think in terms of, as I said, I do think mediation can be very successful, but I think it does depend on the particular complaint. So
yeah.
I wasn't asked for a view at the time.
Right. And in terms of arbitration, again, you weren't part of the decision making, but did you have a view at all that this might be advantageous in any way to the complainers, given the level of publicity which has resulted and would inevitably result when things went to trial and during the judicial review process initially?
I wasn't asked for a view, I didn't take a view on at the time.
And now would you have a view?
I think it would depend on the particular circumstances. And as I said, I wasn't involved in the investigation, so I know I didn't know what the full complaints were, so I wouldn't be appropriate, I don't think, for me to comment.
Yeah, but you were involved prior to the investigation.
I was involved prior to the investigation, but wasn't involved at that stage.
Right, but given your involvement prior to the investigation and your knowledge of the narrative, etc., do you think arbitration might have been something to at least consider?
I am assuming that these things were given full consideration at the time. I mean, as I said, I wasn't involved and I didn't know how it had progressed from my early contact, so I don't think it would be appropriate for me to comment.
Right, so who was rejecting mediation, do you know that, and who rejected arbitration?
No, I understand that the complainants were asked, I think, at least about mediation, but I don't know the detail of... who took decisions on that.
Right, so none of that was discussed at Cabinet?
At Cabinet?
At Cabinet. I know you did attend some Cabinet meetings where the procedure was... No,
I wasn't involved in Cabinet. I don't attend Cabinet meetings.
Okay, thank you.
Well, that seems to be us. Can I thank Ms Allison very much for her evidence today? And that concludes the public evidence session for today, and we'll now move into private session.
Thank you.